I left the other tripod at school. I was starting recording classes anymore. Okay, so we're back at the Healthy Home. Thank you so much for hosting us. And we're going to do a few weeks of kitchen kashrus. I said we'll take a break from Shabbos and Yom Kippur and stuff like that we're doing for a while. And we're going to talk about the halachos of the kitchen. I don't have like a real set curriculum. I have a few topics that I want to cover, but I have a feeling that the way it goes, we'll get in from one topic to another, and you know, things will come up along the way, and we'll plan out the classes that way. But I figured what I wanted to start with was, I think, is the most common question that comes up now on the WhatsApp group, I think for sure, and also just talk about ovens and microwaves and that whole topic, just to discuss it from beginning to end, explain it in depth and detail, like what's it all about. Why is the halacha that way? And hopefully from an understanding, so then somebody will know what to do. And there's always all different opinions that you hear and all different things, and wrapping and not wrapping, and what to do when you're traveling and kashering, and you have to wait to kasher or not wait to kasher, and all these things are like all different things that people hear. So I want to try to explain the whole topic, from beginning to end, explaining what the different opinions are that, that you hear along the way, and the ones that are, considered to be the postman that I've discussed this with, the way it is. Now, I grew up very, very machmir in this area. I grew up wherever in my home, and we were always very, very careful about the oven. The oven was, only dairy, and anything meat in there had to be wrapped up and whatever it is. We would never use the oven back and forth. And what happened was I got married, and we were in Kolo, one of the first years in Ora Chaim, in Yeshiva in Queens, and it was Purim time. I think it was our first year, Shana Rishon, our first year of marriage. And my wife made hamantashen. And what I made was a little note on the hamantashen that said, hamantashen were baked in a fleishig oven. And my intention was that people should know that they shouldn't have those hamantashen with milk, coffee with milk, because they were baked in a fleishig oven. And I felt very, good. I was like, telling everybody all this. And so we get there in Yeshiva, and the different people, including one of the rebbeim, and there was one of the rebbeim there, Rebbe Blumen, and he said, why did you put that note on it? So I said, because, he said, who said that's a problem? Why is that, this book was on Yeshiva, who said that's a problem? Why is that a problem? I said, doesn't it make it inflated? Well, what makes it inflation? The fact that it's there. And he gave me a tape to listen to, of a Rav in Lakewood by the name of Shmuel Felder. And I ended up at the time, it was like audio cassettes, so going back, 21 years ago. And I ended up listening to dozens and dozens of cassettes from this Rav of Shmuel Felder. He's still in Lakewood now, a huge Talmud Chacham, very big posek. And the first tape I heard was this tape about ovens. This whole, the whole tape about ovens, and giving over basically a lot of the things that I'm going to be explaining to you now. But I just remember hearing it also for the first time. To me, it was like a revelation. I know when I speak to people about this, a lot of people have it in their head, like a very, very strict approach to ovens. Some people have a very lenient approach, which is also not right when it comes to microwaves and things, which we'll speak about. I would really like to make it very clear, in terms of what's going on, how an oven works in terms of kashrus, what are the issues are, what does kashering an oven do, how to kashrus, all these things. I want to really try to make it clear, hopefully just in one class tonight, and then we'll take it from there. Okay, so this is almost all of this is based on one tshuva in Igros Moshe, Moshe Feinstein, who was the great posek in America, who passed away in the 80s. So he was like the posek who dealt with modern appliances for the first time, modern American appliances in America, all of these things. He was the first time that you find a tshuva in print about gas, to my knowledge, about gas range and all of these things in terms of the whole Shabbos and these types of things. Certainly in America is, Moshe Feinstein. He has a whole tshuva about ovens, he has a tshuva about dishwashers, all of these things, Moshe Feinstein was the one who dealt with. And by and large, his approach is the one that really remains, and that's the one that the poskim, seem to go with, as a normative approach. So let's just try to explain what an oven is and how it works, and what the dynamics are, what are we worried about, etc. So we're going to start talking just about a regular pot, because this is what's discussed in Shulchan Aruch. Shulchan Aruch does talk about an oven in a different context, which we'll get to much later. But for now, let's just talk about a pot. So picture the following. I'll sit here with in front of us, like a cross section of a pot. So you've got the wall of the pot here, the base, and then the wall going up. And now pour into the bottom of the pot a little bit of milk, an inch of milk. Okay, now we turn on the fire and we heat up the pot. So what happens? We all know at this point that once the milk reaches the temperature of Yad Soled, once it turns hot, so the taste of the milk now starts to get infused into the walls of the pot, and now we call this pot a dairy pot, right? It's a milking pot. Why? Because it's got taste from milk put into the walls of the pot. Okay, now, what happens if I have a lid that was used just a few minutes ago on a fleishig pot, on a meat pot? So what's the problem with the lid? Well, when you put a lid on a pot, let's say over here we have our bisari pot, and here, you know, there's meatballs in this pot, and I put the lid on top of it. So what's happening? So the heat builds up in that pot, the steam builds up in the pot, and the Shulchan Aruch explains, which makes a lot of sense, that the steam, once you get thick steam, so the steam conveys taste, right? In other words, steam like creates a connection between whatever it's filling up with steam. So when you've got a pot full of meatballs filling up with steam, so just like the milk infused the walls of the pot with milk, so that the walls of this pot are going to be infused with meatballs, as will the lid, right? The whole thing is enclosed, and it's all full of meat. Now, I take this lid, I wash it off, it's rinsed off, it's cold, right? And now I take this, you know, meat-infused lid, and I put it onto my dairy pot. So what's going to happen? What's going to make my dairy... What's going to happen over here? So we all understand that the lid is going to be a problem right away, right? As soon as the steam from the milk goes up into the lid. So now I have a lid that is infused both with meatballs and with milk. We're good so far? Yeah, so the lid is for sure going to be a problem right now. But the question is anything going to happen to the milk, right? Well, how is it? So the Shulchan Aruch says the milk can be affected in one of two ways. One way is like we just said over here, that once you've got a lid on a pot and it's hot and it's filling up with steam, so that steam now is going to create a connection, right? The steam is going to build up in the pot. It's going to connect this fleishig taste in the lid. It's going to pull out that taste into the steam itself and mingle back down into the milk. And we have now a connection of meat and milk, and the whole thing will become aser. And this is aser min haTorah. This is like mamish full-fledged Bishul Basar V'Chalav. Not only that, it's aser min haTorah, even just to put that lid on the pot, just to cook together meat and milk in a pot is prohibited to do, to cook taste of meat and milk together. So this is full-fledged Basar V'Chalav what you have over here. Okay, so but the post can discuss in the same place in Shulchan Aruch, well, what if you've got a vent on the top of the pot? Right? Let's say you make lines and holes in the top of the pot, and you let the steam out. So does that change anything? So let's go step by step. So as far as the lid, it's not going to change the lid, right? The lid is for sure being penetrated by milk steam that's coming up and soaking up, you know, not soaking, but whatever you say, you know, going up into the metal of that lid, right? But now we have the steam escaping and not circulating back down into the milk. So maybe my milk will be good. Says the Shulchan Aruch, no, there's another problem here. What's the other problem? Who knows? Condensation, right? What happens now? We all know how cooking works. The steam doesn't just all leave like that, right? Some of that steam stays in the form of water, liquid, droplets at the top of the lid. And once it builds up, what happens? It's going to drip right back down into the pot. And that's going to continue happening. So maybe in the first drop will be batel, and the second drop will be batel, and shishim, etc. But once you have that going for a few seconds, so that's also going to be game over for the milk. And that's in fact what the Shulchan Aruch says. So we have two problems. The Shulchan Aruch actually lists a third problem, because in the olden days, maybe you have still, sometimes you have lids that are like this, but even if you have a lid that has not been used in 24 hours, meaning the taste is already pogum, but the Shulchan Aruch says in the olden days anyway, the lids used to have like a point on the top or an area that it was almost impossible to clean, and even if there wouldn't have been any steam or a taste, in the walls of the lid, but there was this actual meat residue that was stuck in that area, that would also be a problem. The poskim say that doesn't really apply so much nowadays because our pots don't do that, and certainly in an oven, you know, that dynamic is not going to really apply. But that's what the Shulchan Aruch says. These are the two main issues that we have when you're talking about a foreign lid on a dairy pot, a fleishig lid on a dairy pot.
Is benyomo, not benyomo.
Let's just say for our point, yeah, just say for our purposes, say everything is benyomo, just for our purposes.
No,
is in the same day. Yeah, like right now, like I just gave the example, here's my meatballs, here's my milk, that's for now, I don't want to make it complicated with this. I want it just to clarify what the dynamics are.
It was fleishig just like recently.
Right now, meatballs cooking right here, I took off the lid, I rinsed it off, and I put it onto the dairy pot. I just want to keep it simple for now, and then we'll get to all of these things as we go along.
Are you talking about it's clean? It's not like got meat splattered on it.
In the meantime. Think about it for a second. What's the difference? Well, so far, based on what I've said, what's the difference whether there's meat splattered on it or not?
Because Because if there's not, I don't know, I was thinking then the meat essence wouldn't come down, but it's not really the meat essence, it's the treif essence.
It's the taste that's in the lid. In other words, the way that this works is that that hot steam, or just like the hot milk or anything, it pulls the taste that's in the wall of the metal, you know what I mean? So that's the way it works. So it doesn't matter if there's the meat splatter. That's like that third case that I was giving before. They said doesn't apply so much when you have that you know point where you have like the meat that's stuck up, and that's exactly what it's talking about. Is that case? So if you have a dirty lid, that would be the case. My point was that for what we're talking about here, for the way that it works, it doesn't make a difference really if it's clean or not. In other words, if there would be no steam, or somehow we could make it that the steam would not condensate on the top of the lid and drip down, so then even if it would be meat up here, it would have no way of affecting the milk, right? In other words, the pot lid the lid is going to be treif no matter what. The lid is always going to be treif because the lid is for sure affected by the meat, and it's for sure affected by the milk, right? But our question here, and when we're talking about an oven, our question is how does that lid go back and affect the milk that's cooking in it? And there's only two ways that it could do that. There's no magic. The taste doesn't jump across. It has to be some medium. So that medium is either thick steam filling up that transfers the taste between the two, or condensation droplets that form and drip down into the food, which you have even if there's steam that's escaping. Okay. But what this means is, let's say you could have a scenario, you could create a scenario, let's say you would make a lid that not only did it have a slit on it, but it also had, you know, exhaust fans or something, right? So that it would, not only would it not fill up with steam, but there was no chance for condensation. Or there was a condensation catcher, or you know, something like that. There was some way that you could some way you could make it so that no steam would build up in there. So, you know, what would be the problem, right? In other words, you wouldn't be able to do it because you're making your lid treif, but you would not be able to affect the milk, because if there's no buildup of steam and there's no condensation, so that milk is not going to be affected by the meat lid, right? It's there, but it can't affect anything. So says Rav Moshe Feinstein the following: we look at an oven like a big pot. That's how we're going to look at an oven. Right? So we have the walls of the oven, and we've got the top of the oven, that's like the lid of the pot, and we put stuff into our oven. So let's think about this. Let's talk about a treif oven. Let's just make this the easiest case. So I have an oven here, and you know, a non-Jewish person comes, I'm in a hotel, and just a few minutes ago, they roasted, you know, totally not kosher meat over here in this oven, and, you know, and let's say they cleaned it out, for starters, you know, just for argument's sake. Let's say they didn't even. Let's just make it like worst case scenario. They didn't clean it out. It's dirty with splatter of meat. Okay. Now, a Jewish person comes and doesn't know, makes a mistake, whatever, and puts a pan of lasagna open into that oven and starts cooking it. Okay. So everyone's immediate reaction would be, oh my gosh, it's terrible and it's treif. But let's just picture the scene, right? We have walls of an oven that are infused with treif. We've maybe got some grease on the sides of the oven that are actual treif, and we have a lasagna cooking in the oven. Okay, well.
Sorry, can you just clarify, is this a big American oven or an Israeli oven?
Well, for now, you're a step ahead of us already, but for now I'm just talking about an oven for starters, and then we're going to narrow it down for this in a second, exactly. But just as far as just understanding the dynamics of what's going on over here, right? So how is my lasagna, I'm asking you, right? How can my lasagna be affected by that non-kosher grease? It's not magic. It doesn't jump across, right? So what are the
steam.
Okay? So either through steam or through condensation, right? There has to be some conduction, right? There has to be some way of a connection that happens between that lasagna and that treif. We're not talking yet about the racks, right? That's a trick, because the taste could go through the rack into the lasagna also, which we'll talk about. Right?
Do you still through a rack, through a pan to the lasagna?
Well, we'll talk about it. We'll get to the rack separately. Right. In the meantime, I'm ignoring the rack. I'm just talking about the oven. We'll get to the rack separately. The racks are a separate issue. Right. But in the meantime, right, there's only two ways, right? So Rav Moshe Feinstein says the following. He says like this. He says, in a large size oven, which is the American size oven, which I was trying to look up online. I don't know. There's no like official average, but we're talking about like 6 cubic feet plus. You know, which is like standard, I think, from what I understand. Is that correct? Do you guys know these things? Or no? The 30-inch oven, it's like a 30-inch oven, they call it. Like a 30-inch oven is a regular standard American oven. So the motion says that you have no way of the oven affecting the food, right? Because there's no buildup of steam. Because they vent, and they're so large that there's no, like, and you don't have condensation dripping down from the tops of ovens. Right? In a microwave you do, which we'll get to in a second, right? So Moshe Feinstein says the following, that in a large size American oven, right? Again, forgetting about the racks for a second, we have to address the racks separately, but an oven can be used for milk and meat, open. That's what Moshe Feinstein says, right? Not at the same time, which we'll get to in a second, right? It's not even so obvious, right? But the evidence in certain situations, it's mutter, even if a person did it by accident, right? But we'll talk about why it's a problem to do a chatchila, you're not supposed to. And parav and meat that you should not do, and parav and there you shouldn't do a chatchila to keep it that way. But you don't need to let it cool down in between. You don't need to let it wait 24 hours or burn it out in between, because he says the following. He says
that people know that.
More people do, and people do it, but this is what he said. What are you saying? That's what I'm saying. I was very surprised when I heard this whole shiur for the first time. But then obviously since then I've looked into this my whole halacha career, and you know, obviously all these things, and I'm still going with the same sock as 21 years ago when I heard that tape. This is what Moshe Feinstein says. He says that in large, I didn't grow up like this either, like I said at the beginning, but in a full size American oven, this does not apply here in Israel, does not apply in Europe.
The small
ovens that we'll talk about in a minute, it does not apply to those, because of those they do fill up with steam. It's just the fact that the way that it works. But in a regular size 30 inch or whatever that is, in a regular full size American oven with a range on top and the oven on the inside, so this is what Moshe Feinstein says, this is what we do at home. You're allowed to cook open dairy, open meat in the same oven, one after the other, with one or two provisions, which I want to get to in a second. But as far as this idea of it making it treif, so now you're asking me, so why do we clean out an oven and everything for Pesach and all these other things? The answer is, first of all, Pesach is a lot more machmir. We treat Pesach a lot more strictly than we Chametz on Pesach a lot more strictly than we do Kashrus. And even when it comes to Kashrus, if we can, of course, we kasher out an oven if it's treif, and you don't move into a house that's treif and just use the oven that's treif like that, because sometimes things happen and things spill and things fall, and you want to have a. But as far as using an oven, which you're going to use carefully, which we're going to explain how in a second, as far as the racks, covering the racks, etc., but using an oven carefully backwards, back and forth from milchigs to fleishigs, so that is permissible to do, open milchigs and open fleishigs.
Does that have to be clean? The
rack has to be. As long as you don't have something there that's like steaming or smelling, which we're going to get to in a second. Mm-hmm. Smell is an issue, which we'll get to in a second, and that's why you can't do it at the same time, because the halacha is as follows. There's a big question in the Gemara in general whether reicha milchsa, does smell count for anything? You know what I mean? If I have a piece of cheese that is infused with smell of meat, so does that affect that cheese? Am I allowed to eat that cheese, or is there somehow considered to be some essence of meat in that smell? You know, is there some some mixture there? So the halacha is, that the Gemara comes out, that lechatchila we are strict. In other words, we don't do things that will lechatchila mix two smells together. And people who are very, very strict about this, I remember there was one Rebbe in YU, and I remember when I was in Yeshiva, I didn't go there, but I remember when I was in Yeshiva, people used to speak about it, and really, really machmir, all these things, they had two freezers and two everything, like you wouldn't keep cheese and meat in the same freezer, because, there's like, you open up a freezer and you get a little bit of a smell, so he was worried about this, you wouldn't do it. Okay, so that, we don't do that to that extent, but that's an issue in terms of, so if your oven, let's say you just cooked an open pan of meat, and your oven like smells of meat, so lechatchila you can't use it right now for open, open dairy. You have to let it air out a little bit. But that's not an issue of like the heat or the taste or this or that. And b'di'evet, if a person didn't let it air out, it would not be aser. It would not make the food prohibited. But even if the food came out with a smell, which probably wouldn't, but it wouldn't be aser. But lechatchila we don't mix up the smell, the essence of the smell of meat and milk together, or treif or kosher together. So that's another reason to keep the oven clean, because when you have meat splatter on the oven, So it gives off a smell. It gives off like a greasy smell. Once it gets to a point that it's totally burnt out and it's just like that black, so that's, you know, that's not a problem anymore. It doesn't smell, it doesn't smoke, it doesn't steam, doesn't do anything. Okay, so this is step one. As far as the ovens are concerned, again, we're talking about in America or here in Chutz La'aretz, if you have an American sized oven, a large, large 30 inch or whatever that's called, several cubic feet oven. So this, as far as the oven wall is concerned, as far as the smell is concerned, we addressed it. But as far as the grate, so we have to understand what the issue is over here. Okay, so let's try to understand what would the problem be. So let's picture now we're inside our oven. Let's say the table is going to be the oven grate, and we're going to take our pan of lasagna and put it here. Now what happened? 5 minutes ago, 10 minutes ago, whatever, you know, you just heard this year, you heard, you can go back and forth. So you had that big pan of meatballs, it was cooking in the oven, and you pulled it out, and it sloshed over the side, and it spilled meat, you know, gravy and juice all over the oven grate. Okay? So you take out the grate, you rinse it off in the sink, it's totally clean, no residue of meat, totally, you know, with soap, everything totally clean. Put it back into the oven, and you want to now put your lasagna in the oven. Okay, so can you do that or not? So let's see, what would the problem be? I have an oven grate now that is infused with the taste of meat in it, right? So that itself is not a problem. It's only a problem if that taste is going to somehow get to my lasagna or my lasagna pan. I don't want my pan to become trafe either, right? Even if it won't affect the lasagna, let's say. So the question is like this. When I put down a pan on the grate, and it's very hot, does that allow taste to transfer? Similarly, right? Let's just take the case different, but it's really the same case. I have a very, very hot pot of chalent. I take my crock pot out of my, out of the thing, the insert, and it's too hot, there's a hole in the glove, and I put it down on the dairy counter, and I put it down there. Is that a problem, right? But when you have two hard items, two kalim, no food, no liquid, no food involved, right? But a grate and a pan, or a countertop and a chalent pot, or by the same token, when you're talking about a grate of a burner, right? The burner grates of a, you go to a hotel and you want to, you know, boil up water in a tea kettle on the hotel, you know, burner. But who knows? Maybe just right before me, there was somebody that cooked, bacon and eggs on that burner this morning, and that bacon and eggs spilled on the burner, and there's meat, you know, infused into that grate. So can I take my kosher kettle and put it down on that oven, that burner?
Why is there a difference in your own kitchen? You have the same.
Oh, for meat and milk. Okay, so the same thing. Yeah, if I spill milk onto that grate. Well, if there's no spill, so then there's nothing in it, right? Oh, you're saying
so
even that, even just
really
it, even just it, yeah, boil
the pot.
Or the pot's on it. Okay, so or you're saying even without that, I'm making an assumption. Right? Yeah, let's say I just have a meat pot that I put onto that grate. So does the grate become fleshig, right? Because just like that. Okay, so halacha is like this. Is an interesting thing that the way the halacha works, and there's a question in this. Whether you're allowed to do this or not, or if it's only if it was done that we apply the following. But the rule is as follows. The Shulchan Aruch writes, Ein bliot yotzin likli likli below rotev. That when with two utensils, without a liquid medium, without liquid in between, taste will not transfer. Okay? Without liquid in between, there's no transfer of taste. If you have just two pots that touch each other on the stove, you know, which can happen sometimes, you've got a big chicken soup pot, and then you've somebody cooking a dairy oatmeal or something in another pot, and the two pots touch each other on the stove, right? And you've got milk cooking in this pot and chalent cooking in that pot. So if they're dry and clean on the outside, nothing is trafe. Just separate them. Okay, that's the halakha.
So let's say you're making chicken soup for Shabbos, and someone's making macaroni and cheese. The steam's coming up. But it's dissipating.
No, that's a fine. That's fine. I'm talking about where the pots are touching.
So they're
sides
right.
To touch.
Yeah, where the sides touch. So okay. If they touch, it's not a problem. Now, are you allowed to? And therefore, once again, let's go back to all of these cases that we said. So that would mean that let's go back to my oven grate. I just spilled meatballs on a sauce all over the grate. I rinsed it off, so it's clean and it's dry. And now it's in my oven, and I put my lasagna down on top of it. Right. So. If my lasagna spills as I'm taking it in or out, right? Let's say I'm pushing it in, a little bit of lasagna spills over the edge, and now I slide the, so I'm in big trouble, right? Because now I have mamish basar b'chalav going on, for real. I think
it's just
wet
with water.
But with water also, no, so that's also
water.
The question is how much it needs to be, which we'll get to maybe in a second. In other words, there needs to be a certain amount. Maybe one drop of water is not. It's already a machlokas. It's already getting into a question of how much liquid there needs to be. According to some, even a few drops is a problem. Some say there needs to be like an amount in a pan or a pot or something along those lines. But that's already getting into problems, once you're talking about how much liquid there was in between the two things. But sometimes I'd say in a shaila, where somebody uses the wrong spatula in a pan to move things around, or scrapes a pan or does something. So in a case like that, where you're talking about things that are totally dry, so there are times that it wouldn't be. You could probably, well, the truth is the food is not the same thing. Okay, let's leave that aside for now. So putting down my lasagna pan on top of this grate. So first of all, question number one is, like we said, that it's questionable already if you're allowed to do that lechatchila, meaning even though taste is not going to transfer from the pan into the grate or vice versa, according to some poskim, you're not allowed to do that lechatchila, the same way you would never think to lechatchila push your macaroni and cheese pot and your chicken soup pot together on the stove, right? You would try to keep them separate, and if they would touch, you would have a shaila. So now okay, if they touch, it's aser, it's mutter, if they touch, it's not aser, it's mutter b'dyeved. But lechatchila, you're supposed to keep them separated, right? So same thing over here. Lechatchila, you're not allowed to, you shouldn't, put that pan down onto that grate. And it can create real problems, even b'dyeved. If that pan spills and it touches, now you've got a transfer really of meat. Let's just speak it through because I stopped in the middle. As I'm putting in that pan, let's say some of the liquid or whatever, it sloshes back and forth and it spills over the edge, and now I push the lasagna on top of it. So now, to zoom into that place. So here's the grate, which has meat taste, that in the meantime was trapped. It couldn't get out. And here's my pan that had the lasagna taste, that in the meantime it was trapped and it couldn't get out. But now that there's liquid in between here, so now that meat is going to go into the lasagna pan, and that pan is going to go into the grate, and the grate's going to be trafe for the next time, and my lasagna can be affected by this, right? So for this reason, what you have to do is as follows. If you're using the same oven, which I would say is fine to do, to use for fleishig and milchig and parev, so pick one, which is the one that you use the grate for, as is, and cover the grate for the other one. So like what we do at home is we use bisari, we use it for flesh eggs open, but if we're going to put a pizza, bake pizza, or put in a lasagna, so then we take tin foil and put it down on the grate, and make a few holes in it so that it lets the airflow circulate. You're not supposed to like block it off completely, they say, and then you can put a pan of lasagna or a pizza or anything like that. The idea is, again, the mechanism is to make sure that there's no touching or potential even of touching with liquid between my pan or my tinfoil or my pizza stone or whatever it is that I'm putting in there and the oven grate, right? So if there's a layer of tinfoil, that's protecting it. So even if there's going to be a spill, the spill is going to be between the tinfoil and the pan, not between the tinfoil and the grate, right? Even if it would spill at this point, if my tinfoil is covered, so there'll be...
Rack is covered by the tinfoil.
I'm sorry, yes. If my tinfoil is covering the rack, thank you, yes. So the bars of the rack, that meat has nowhere to go because it's only going to be touching dry tinfoil. The tinfoil will be wet on the top, so there'll be transference between the tinfoil and the pan, but the tinfoil and the meat have no medium for the liquid, for the taste to go through.
Okay, so question. So I go to my mother's house, and in America, the American says oven. Most things that are made in the oven are kosher, but it almost doesn't even matter, right? And I makpid that every time when I go there, I make chicken for Shabbos and I wrap it really well and I don't take it out unless it's wrapped. They have like these inserts, they're like these big, foil things.
Yeah.
I can put that on the rack, I can put it in the chicken, and I can roast it.
It's not treif.
It's a clean oven.
Not treif.
Any meat that's made in there is kosher.
Yes.
The sauces, but there's any meat. It's in terms of that.
Yes.
I can put an open pan and I can make lasagna even also, as long as I'm using an insert, over the...
Yes. In a full size oven, yes. Yes.
I wish I would have done this years ago.
Mine's fine.
Okay.
Yes.
That's but that's the, again according to there definitely are people who don't do this. Definitely people who are masturbating this. I don't know what they're worried about.
In other words, but you can put in a lasagna and cover it as long as
the yeah, for sure, covered for sure. Oh, so now let's talk about smaller ovens. Now that we understand what's going on, we understand what the mechanism is, we understand what the issues are. So I want to address smaller ovens and try to understand how do we get around the problem, or how can I get then cook in a smaller oven? Because in the small oven you have really both of these issues. Certainly in a toaster oven or a microwave oven, I picture, you know, a toaster oven, even you put toast in there, the steam that comes up, right? The toaster oven, if you that steam, this condensation, this liquid that's there. And if you put something liquidy in a toaster oven, it totally, you know, fills up. And in a microwave, certainly, every time you open a microwave, basically, it, you know, steam billows out of the microwave. That will never happen in a big oven, right? You'll never open up in a big oven. You'll be hit with heat, but you don't be hit with steam that your glasses will fog up, that you'll be able to touch your glasses like that. That'll never happen in an oven.
No, but in Israel, but at home here, so I open my oven and my glasses steam.
In the small oven.
In the Israeli
oven. Yeah, because it's much smaller. The steam doesn't get out. That's exactly the difference, right? So in a microwave, in a toaster oven, also these European ovens, like we have here in Israel, like the wall ovens that size, so this doesn't apply. So then your oven is either fleishig or milchig, and anything that you put in there, now you have to realize it's like you're putting it into a fleishig pot. Right? If I was cooking, you know, a lasagna in a fleishig pot, what would I do? So, wow, how can I do that? So I guess the only way to do that is to make sure that there's no possible contact between the lasagna and the pot, right? And no steam and no condensation and no dripping. And that means it has to be wrapped, right? So this idea that it has to be double wrapped, so that doesn't say that anywhere in halacha. There's also no such concept of double. It doesn't say, because some people have this strange thing, if I put a piece and I put a piece of paper towel, and then I put a plate, does that count as a double wrapping? Because there's two things there, right, stopping it. So no, that maybe doesn't count as anything, because the point of wrapping is to prevent interaction between the walls of the microwave, or the splatter of the microwave, or the walls of the oven and the food. And that interaction, again, only takes place either through steam or through condensation. So wrapping means that there has to be enough of a wrap that I'm confident that there's no connection between
the whole thing.
Exactly. The whole thing has to be wrapped in such a way that there's no steam escape. And I've had this, which is a very unfortunate event to happen, only one time. On one of these trips, I was traveling and I bought food in one place, then traveled to another place, and there's a microwave in the hotel room, and I put it in, and it popped completely, and exploded with steam everywhere. And I don't remember, I don't remember what happened. It was a long time ago, but that's already a problem, right? Because once if you wrap it in just a plastic bag and there's no holes in the plastic bag, even though it's flimsy, but you open it up and all the steam is contained, so then you're good. That's fine. Even one bag, if it's wrapped really well, and when you open it up, you see clearly that there's no steam, and all the steam is in the bag, so then you're good.
The same for an oven. Like, you would need to separate from the wrap, but you only need maybe one piece of foil on top.
Same idea. If it's crimped closed, and it's closed well, and it's enough that it's you're confident that there's no steam and no spillage, nothing getting in or out, so then that's enough. There's nothing magical about double. The Shulchan Aruch even gives a case where something was wrapped in dough, and what was inside the dough was mutter. Picture like they made some sort of a quiche with a dough on top in a fleishig oven. So the dough was enough to protect what was inside. That was like the idea in that circumstance. So it doesn't have to be hermetically sealed, but it has to be enough that you're confident that the transfers of taste that we're worried for, which is the steam and the condensation, that they're not going
to
happen.
So the bottom of the kli doesn't have to be covered. Like, it doesn't have to be wrapped all around. Even though
it doesn't have to. Let's say if you have like a Tupperware or something that's microwave safe and a microwave safe seal, you know what I'm saying? So that would be enough, because
you don't worry about the bottom getting
tripped. The bottom touching.
Yeah, so just put a napkin down, a napkin between the thing and the glass. Paper. Yeah, as long as there's no spilling, then just like a napkin or something is fine.
Or in a tray oven, like a piece of foil or something.
Yeah, exactly. Foil, the same thing. Yeah, correct. Foil on
rack. You supposedly use double pan.
Double pan, exactly. That's also fine. Although double pan is a little bit, just you have to be worried, because in a double pan you could still spill over both of them, and that's already a problem. You know what I mean? So it's better to cover the rack, to make sure that the rack is covered, or to use like a wider pan and a smaller pan, a big pan and a small pan, you could do. But the idea is to make sure that no liquid is going to get in between. But you know what? Maybe I'm making a mistake. I don't know. When, let's say the double pan.
You don't want to get between them, but if it didn't get between them.
But liquid might get in between also. If it spills, it could get in between and underneath. I don't know already. Okay, that you'd have to see. But you understand the point. Is I want you to understand the idea. Now you know how you could protect it any way you want But
the idea is. Are you concerned about the food and the pot?
Well, everything would end up being potentially. You know, let's just take that case. Let's take even with the double pan. So I have a double pan of a lasagna, and I'm putting it into a tray for a fleishig, small, full size oven, right? So I'm putting it in like this, and as I put it in, so it sloshes over the side. So now, what I'm worried about is a potential. I don't know. You could check and see what happened. But if there's here's the fleishig grate, and now I've got liquid between the grate and the bottom pan. I probably have liquid between the bottom pan and the top pan, and then my lasagna. So that allows for the meat taste to go straight up from the grate through the pans up into the lasagna, since you've got heat and liquid there. Really, b'di'evad, I don't. If you would ask me on this group, it would end up being mutter. I think such a case, but we don't want to set that up with achila. That's the idea.
But an Israeli
oven. Oh, so an Israeli oven, the rack is the same. You have to cover it just the same back and forth. But there you have the added issue of steam buildup affecting the food. So whereas in an American oven, I'm okay to cook an open chicken and an open lasagna, provided there's no residual smell. In an Israeli oven, you would have to cover the lasagna, because in an Israeli oven, you do have a buildup of the steam.
But doesn't the steam touch the sides of the pot also?
Why
worry about the racks more than the rest of
the pot? Well,
the
steam doesn't.
No, because the steam is inside the pot. It doesn't get out. You don't.
No, there's steam.
You're not making new steam because it can't escape.
Right, you're not.
If it's covered, then the steam's not escaping, so there's no steam being.
Right, there's no steam outside.
We're not making any steam. Okay.
We're making steam, but it's all enclosed.
So if I open the oven, I won't be hit with.
Exactly,
steam.
That's the problem. Right, that's when I go away and I open up the microwave. So I make sure I look to see that it's all clear, and then I open the bag, and then it like kind of shrinks on itself, you know, and then I know, okay, so that it's good. It all, you know, no steam got out. So same thing here. I just have to make sure. Again, it's not even that no steam got out, if you think about it. Let's say you open it up afterwards, you see, oh man, there was a little rip in the side. So you just have to think about it logically, look at it, see, do you think this was enough, that it's really steamed up, that it made condensation, you could check the top and see if the top is dry, and this is not enough of a rip that you think it would have filled up the whole thing. Exactly. So you can be chachmatic about it. It's not like, you know what I mean? The idea is your food is only going to be treif if there's some connection made with the walls of that oven or microwave. Now, again, in a microwave, you see it, b'chush, you see it when you open it up, it's full of steam. So, but in a small oven, you have to see. So you have to try to cover something and cover it well and make sure it doesn't escape. But if you see that there's a rip or you see there's a hole, or you see there's something, so it's certainly a shaila, certainly what to look at. And you can see for yourself if you're confident that, you know, there's no way this filled up with steam, it didn't, whatever, or it didn't even get so hot yet, or whatever it is, so then, you know, then it's fine. There's no way for the taste to have gotten into your food. It's not, again, it's like I started with, there's no magic that you put something in an oven and the taste transfers across. The closest thing to that is the smell, you know, the fact that that residual smell is around, so that we try not to mingle, that's as close as you get to, like, a leap of taste. But you know, once something is cleared out, so then there has to be a way for the connection to happen. Okay, now, understanding this, so this is also the idea behind, people talk about kashering microwaves. So I want to just address this also. It was also something that there's a lot of confusion about. The truth is I changed my mind, not my mind, but my approach to this, over the years. From Rabbi Weiss, really only the past couple of years, I always used to be, machmir on microwaves and say that you can't kasher them, and they can't be kashered. And my feeling always was that because what happens in a microwave, first of all, you have all the steam that's going, but sometimes you also have like a splattering of food that goes against the side, and then that food is being heated up and cooked into the side. And when you kasher a microwave, you only kasher with steam, right? You're only pulling out this, you're only using, and we have a general rule when it comes to kashers, that the way something got in, it has to come out. For example, I don't want to get into this now. We spoke about this Pesach time. We probably will again. So I don't want to get so much into it now. But the Mishnah Berurah says when you're kashering a countertop, if it's a countertop that maybe a hot piece of chametz fell onto, or maybe you put a hot pot down that was wet, so he says it's not enough just to pour water to kasher. You also have to go over with an evan meluban. You have to go over with a hot stone. Right? I think we mentioned this, using an iron on a countertop and these types of things. If you're not covering it, you're not covering counters. And you have to go over with a hot stone. Why? Because pouring the water is not enough. Pouring the water will kosher it for the things that spilled there. But for the things that were placed down there, pouring is not strong enough. So that was always my feeling about the microwave, that you're koshering it with steam. So that, true, that's enough to kosher it from the steam that got embedded into it. But I didn't feel that it was enough. I didn't think it was enough to kosher it from the actual food that, like, you know, splatters and goes against the side of it. But the Weiss explained, and I only spoke to him very briefly about this, but he was makel about this, and he holds as follows, which he holds you can kosher it this, so I can kosher anything else, which means that if you have to clean it thoroughly, which means, you know, you have to really look and see anything inside of it, and usually they can get cleaned pretty well in a microwave if you keep it in decent shape, and, you know, it's usually in a hotel or a motel it can be cleaned very thoroughly. But then it has to wait for 24 hours. This is always, you know, a rule in koshering. And I've had some of the students have told me on the WhatsApp group that they have roommates or different people have told them that they don't do this in 24 hours. I don't understand how that could be. Any time you kosher something, if you kosher it within 24 hours, so all you're doing is re-trafing it. All you're doing is reawakening the taste that's in it and recirculating taste. The whole point of koshering something is you want to pull that taste out. And by pulling it out, now it's clean. But if the taste is still trafe, it's still within 24 hours, it's still trafe taste. So all I'm doing is pulling it out, and then it's making the steam trafe and going back into the walls of the microwave. So I don't really understand. If there's a rabbi out there, wants to tell me what the idea is behind it, how you could kosher within 24 hours. I don't understand what it is.
You clean it, you wait 24 hours.
If you clean it and you wait 24 hours, and now, I just realized right now, while I'm telling you, maybe I'm wrong, but I just realized this. That's when it comes to trafe, that you have to wait 24 hours. But between milk and meat, if it's not trafe, then maybe you don't need to wait 24 hours. Maybe that's what you meant.
Since the microwave walls don't get hot.
Right, but they get hot from the stuff that touches it. So you have to, just like a countertop doesn't get hot, right? But we have to kosher a countertop for the stuff that spills on it. So the stuff that splashes against the microwave or that is stuck on the wall and gets cooked and cooked and cooked and cooked into it, so that needs to be pulled out. That needs to get koshered, just like a countertop. So it's not less than a countertop. And in fact, it's more, because it's the food is being heated while it's in contact with it. The countertop, you know, something spills on it, or I put a pot down on it, it's cooling off. But here, let's say you have a piece of meat or a piece of trafe that, you know, flung out of a thing. We just had this yesterday. Mom just had this yesterday, heating up challah from Shabbos. Never had this before. I don't know why. Like a little piece of meat in my daughter's bowl of challah, it actually exploded. Like, there were little shreds of meat in every shetach of my. I never saw it before, but if Mom sure happened, it actually exploded. And now what happens? The microwave is still going for another minute. That piece of meat is being cooked and cooked and cooked and cooked. It's sizzling super hot into the walls of my microwave system. It's, you know, worse than a countertop. So just like you have to kosher a countertop by pouring water, and the Mishnah Berurah says even more than that. So that's what I always thought about a microwave, that you would need to do more than just the steam. But Rav Weiss holds that the steam is enough. What's the reason? I don't know. I think because there's a rule in koshering that you only have to go after the majority of the way something is used. And even if something is used occasionally for something else, you don't have to kosher it for that purpose. I think that's the principle he's working with. Anyway, without getting into all the details, the way he holds the kosher advice to kosher microwaves is as follows. Like I said, clean it. You have to clean it well. Wait 24 hours. Now I'm just wondering, maybe I'm wrong about that when it comes to meat and milk. Maybe between meat and milk, you don't need to wait the 24 hours. I have to double check that for next week. But let's say a non-kosher microwave, or let's say a microwave that became trafe. So you clean it well, you wait 24 hours, and then you have to steam it up very, very stark, very strong, right? Because that's how the taste got into it, was through steam. So just like when we kosher an oven, which we'll talk about, you turn it on to the highest for as long as it goes. So that's kind of what you have to do to the microwave also. So you have to take a mug, it could be any mug, a Parav mug, whatever, any type of mug, and put it in there. Obviously a clean mug also that wasn't used for 24 hours for anything hot. And put it in there and let it, like, you know, totally boil out and totally thick, you know, steam up, more thick with steam than you ever usually let it. I asked the Rav Weiss specifically, do you need to, I saw some posts say you have to move it and then do it again to, like, kosher the spot that it was. He said you don't need to do that. Just letting it steam up like that is fine, and you can kosher it out like that.
What status of cup do you use for the water?
Just a cup that wasn't used for 24 hours. If it was dairy, as long as it's clean, it wasn't used in 24 hours, that's fine. And you can use that if it wasn't used for 24 hours.
So if the microwave is dairy, you have to use a dairy cup. It's not.
I think really what if you have a power of mug, a power of glass, or something like that, that would be best. Technically, you could even use a dairy mug to clean a flashing microwave if the dairy mug itself was also more than 24 hours since it was used.
Oh,
technically,
the mug would still be fine, the microwave still.
Yeah, I think it would still be okay if they were both clean and both had not been 24 hours.
You can microwave?
I think, yeah, this way, yeah, by cleaning it out well, waiting 24 hours, and then steaming it out.
Wouldn't any glass, for drinking, be technically part of anyway?
Glass is like a whole separate discussion, but this is also a very misunderstood topic. But there's a huge difference when it comes to glass between Sfaradim and Ashkenazim. So that's for starters. For Sfaradim, it's very, very simple. The glass cannot become treif. It can't be kosher. Can't be drunk. The can't doesn't need to be kosher. That's what the Shulchan Aruch says. Glass cannot become treif, and therefore a Sfaradi can use hot, glass, hot korel,
and for Pesach.
For everything, Pesach, everything year round, everything they can use glass all year round. It doesn't accept taste. That's what the Shulchan Aruch holds. It does not accept taste. Shia v'lo bali, he says it's smooth, and it does not accept any taste. Now the Ramah, who the Ashkenazim follow, hold the exact opposite end of the spectrum, which holds not only does glass yes become treif. But since glass is made out of sand, it has the status of cheres, it has the status of earthenware, and not only can it become treif, but it can never be kashered. That's what the Ramah says. And that's the halacha for Ashkenazim. People are very confused about this, but if you would have, let's say this pitcher, a glass pitcher, you would put, chicken soup in it one time, and then, hot milk in it another time, it's treif. You can't, you have to throw it out, you can't use it anymore ever again. Maybe you can give it to a Sfaradi, I don't know, but you can't ever use it, and you can't ever use it again. You can't kosher it, and not for Pesach, not during the year. That's really what the Ramah says. Now, for some reason, there's a lot of confusion about this, and so I heard from this Rav also, this is Shmuel Felder, on those same tapes back in from Lakewood in the early 90s or whatever that was. So he said this. He said, because most of the time in Europe, people had glasses that they used for drinking. And for drinking, anyway, it doesn't really become fleishig or milchig. It doesn't. You're never using hot milk or hot meat, let's say, in a tea mug. Forget about coffee. Forget about coffee for now. Yeah, forget about milk and coffee. Let's just leave that aside for now. But he said this is where the confusion came from. Or a cold drinking glass. A cold drinking glass, you could use the same one for a milchig and a fleishig meal because it's not really becoming anything. Yeah? So nowadays, because we have dishwashers and we wash things together and we wash them hot and all these things, so people have separate glasses for milk and meat. But he said this is where it came from, that people got confused about glass because on the one hand, Sfaradim use it interchangeably, and Ashkenazim also, so hey, well, we also use glass interchangeably because people use their drinking glasses interchangeably. So some confusion came into the Ashkenaz world as to the status of glass, and some Ashkenazim are also under this impression that glass is not milchig or fleishig, but really, really it is. Really, it becomes treif, and not only it becomes treif, but it can't be kashrut. Now, all that being said, I heard with my own ears, which I was shocked, but I heard from Rav Scheinberg that he was lenient many times in b'di'evit situations when it came to glass. So, if you ever have a shaila about glass, ask the shaila. Don't just say, "Oh, I remember. We heard Ashkenazim said you can, always have to throw it out." If you have a shaila, you should really ask the shaila. But I'll be the real understanding of halacha and the way it goes. So glass really becomes treif and can't become untreif. So glass wouldn't be the way to go as far as that's concerned. But using something parav, but in this case, anything we're not talking about, nothing would end up becoming treif here anyway, except things more than 24 hours old. Okay, so we just filled with ovens. So make sure we didn't miss anything. Ovens, oven racks, covering, kashering microwaves. Not using. Okay, any questions left? Anything else? Yeah.
Sort of, if you have a milk microwave and a plastic microwave, you want to heat up water in a parv measuring cup. Is it possible? Can you heat something parv? Can you heat up something parv in a parv clean?
A clean microwave. That's good, but it's good. You're talking about making steam, heating up water.
Yeah, you want to you're cooking or something, and you want hot water. We want to make somebody a cup of hot water, or something you don't want it to be.
And you don't want to use the kumkum for, I don't know, I don't see why you should be able to do that. I don't know.
Whatever.
To me, it sounds like, you know, you're making hot water for coffee in a flaky pot. Like, why should you do that? Why could you do that? If it was clean, it wouldn't be also to be added, you know, but I don't, that would be like, I don't think you should do that. I don't know. I'll try to ask my advice.
And if it was just to get
that,
it warm, like room temperature?
Warm is okay, yeah. If it's just warm, or even if you need to get it hot, but you know your microwave well enough and it's not going to boil. Mm-hmm. You're not talking about Averas here. You're not talking about, you know what I mean, not like playing with fire. You know what I mean? You can put it in there and see, and before it starts to steam, take it out, and, you know what I mean, you didn't do anything wrong. You know what I mean? But the...
You're like softening margarine, you're not going to...
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, something exactly. Perfect example. Something like softening margarine that's not going to, like, end up... But let's say you put it on, and then all of a sudden you get a phone call, and then all of a sudden you hear a poof in the microwave, and you look, and it's all full of steam and everything, so then now you can't use that margarine with milk or whatever. You know what? But that's a good example. You want to... If you want to just soften the, you know, soft margarine or something like that, you know, in such a way that it's not going to... you know, definitely not going to steam up or anything like that, or eggs, or who knows, well, you know, something along those lines. So again, the idea of why you should understand what's going on here is so that you'll know what to do and how to apply it. Okay, we'll stop here, Mr. We'll continue next week. More kitchen stuff is good. We'll do. I want to go into Tefillas Kalim a little bit also, like what Kalim need to be Tovild and not Tovild and stuff like that. Maybe we'll do that next week coming up. Okay, very good.
Thank you.